Good morning, Blanchard Church of Christ. Thanks for showing up today. What a beautiful day we have, and hope you enjoy the service. If tomorrow all the things were gone, I'd worked for all my life, and I had to start again, which is my children and my wife. I'd thank my lucky stars to be living here today, 'cause the flag still stands for freedom, and they can't take that away. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. From the lakes in Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston, from New York to LA, well, there's pride in every American heart, and it's time we stand and say. And I'm proud to be an American, at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless.
I love the Lord, for he heard my voice. He heard my cry for mercy. Because he turned his ear to me, I will call on him as long as I live. Good morning! I think that was even better than last week. So I have a couple of announcements for you this morning. Number one, we are in the process of putting together a list of those who are graduating either from high school or college this year to be used for both Graduate Sunday and in our newsletter. If you are a parent or guardian of a high school or college graduate, we are asking you to contact the church office with the following things: the name of your student, where they are graduating from, and a photo of the graduate. We need the photos and information no later than Sunday, May 24th, and if I remember correctly, that is today. Number two, if visiting today, please complete the visitor form found in today's handout and put it in the offering basket after the service. Also, those in the church family can use those forms to update their information if needed. We are having King's Kids Camp this year. It is quarantine edition. We have a spy theme this year where we will uncover the mysteries of his story. It will take place over 2 weeks. The dates are June 15th, 17th, 19th, and 22nd, 24th, and 26th. If you did not get the email that gives you all of this information, please contact the church office and we will make sure you get it. Please note that we are following guidelines. Each session will be capped at 20 kids and then broken down into smaller groups from there. In addition, all efforts will be made to clean all stations between groups of children. And last but not least, we are hosting a drive-in movie on Friday, June 5th at 7:30 p.m. This is going to be a family movie. I heard Toy Story 4 is in the works, and there will be food trucks located around the parking lot as well for purchase on your own. It will be both safe and a wonderful time, and we ask you to practice good social distancing during this time. That is all my announcements for today, so let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for this time once again to lift up your name and to rejoice with how you're working and to honor you. And we look to you, God, because you are the most perfect example of humility and love and faith in action, God. I pray that we can raise your name high today, that we can praise you, that we can honor you. God, that we can look back at our week and see how you've been working and look forward to our week and know that you will be there. God, you are good and we love you. Thank you for this time. Please send your Holy Spirit to be with us today. We love you. We pray all these things in your Son's very precious name. Amen.
Good morning again. Good morning. Our scripture this morning is 1 John 4, 7 through 12. Beloved, let us love one another because God had loved us. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. And this love, not that we have loved God, but he had loved us and sent his Son to be an atonement for sin for us. Beloved, since God loved us so much, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is perfected in us.
Good morning. It's our time of singing and praising. I think you guys know most of these songs. There's only a couple of them, so try to sing along.
From above, from the mountain. this time to remember our brothers and sisters in Christ from the Blanchard Church of Christ that have passed away in this past year, and also remember the men and women that have died for our country. In May 1868, General John A. Logan, the commander-in-chief of the Union Veterans Group known as the Grand Army of the Republic, issued a decree that May 30th should become a nationwide day of commemoration for more than 620,000 soldiers that were recently killed in the Civil War. This day became a federal holiday in 1971, and I think the Beach Creek Blanchard Memorial Day Parade was held every year since then to honor the soldiers that have paid the ultimate sacrifice. I was actually corrected on that. I think the Beach Creek Blanchard Memorial Day Parade has gone on since 1868. So it's a shame we won't be able to have the parade this year. These heroes have shaped our country and have provided us with the freedom that we enjoy today in the United States. Please remember tomorrow that freedom wasn't free, and say a prayer for those who have paid the ultimate sacrifice and for their family members that they've left behind. So thank you to all that have served and continue to serve this great country in our military. I praise God for giving us the greatest example of service by sending His Son to show us what true service looks like. Matthew chapter 20, verse 28. Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and give His life as a ransom for many. On this Sunday before Memorial Day, we read the names and honor those in our congregation that have shaped our lives and served the Blanchard Church of Christ and their own communities. These saints have committed their lives to service of others. Please remember them as I read the names of the servants that have gone home to be with the Lord this year. Shirley DeArmond. Mary Bechtel. Bill Emenheiser. Eileen Dorman. Bob Reeder. John Kephart. Sharon Murray. Marge Eichelberger. Charles Fortescue. Charles Bechtel. Jason Egley. Jane Bechtel. Donna Butler. Gregory Young. Mary Parks. Jean Eberhardt. Dot Davy. Ronald Berry. Lula Moore. Marge Hagen. Sarah Jane Shearer. David Marshall Packer. Ruth Florence. Robert Wilson. Second Timothy chapter 4, verse 7 through 8, the Apostle Paul writes, I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. From now on there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have longed for His appearing. Well done, good and faithful servants. Let us pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we come here this morning in celebration, praising your name, praising you for the men and women that came and served this great country, and that ultimately gave that great sacrifice for our freedom. We praise you and thank you for them. We thank you for our country. We thank you for the freedoms that we enjoy. And we just lift your name on high. And Father, we praise you for each one of these names that I've read. As I went through the list, I know that each person here is affected differently by how that person shaped their life. And we just praise you for the time that we've had with them, and we celebrate in knowing that you sent your son. You loved us so much that you want us to share eternity with you. And we praise you and thank you for that. And ask that you be with each family member as we grieve, that you would fill the hole in our heart with your love, the way only you can do. Father, we praise you and love you. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
Would you please bow your heads as we go to the Lord in prayer? Holy God, we thank you for meeting with us, your children, this morning. Lord, you have created for us once again a beautiful day, and we appreciate all the ways in which you bring beauty and blessing to our lives through the natural world you've created for us. There are so many things in your creation that it both amazes us and gives us awe. We see the beauty and delicate detail that you have placed in plants and animals. We are comforted by the warmth and steady glow of the sun from the time it rises in the morning to the time it sets in the evening. We are speechless when we look up into the heavens at night and see all the stars and worlds that you have placed in their orbits. We breathe your fresh air, and we smile when the fragrance of a flower brings back memories to us. Even when we experience storms, we are amazed at the mighty power and energy that they unleash. Your streams and rivers help to irrigate the land, and the ever-changing seasons are a constant reminder to us of the circle of life. Lord, just from your creation alone, we realize how creative and mighty you are. The same God that created and designed the most massive of creatures on this planet is the same God that taught the hummingbird how to fly, or first showed the spiders to spin such sensitive webs. It all comes from your mind and your hands. How amazing you truly are. Each one of us has a body more complicated than any man-made machine. You have designed us so that we can be protected from the smallest of microscopic germs to the greatest of enemies. Our minds were created to be such an intricate system that even today we can't say that we totally understand all of its mysteries. And yet, Lord, there are times that we arrogantly act like we have all the answers. The creation has turned our backs on the Creator. We believe sometimes that it is we who control the world we live in and not you. When you see how selfish and conceited we can act at times, I'm not sure if it brings a laugh to your lungs or to a tear to your eye. I'm sure there are times that our haughty actions make you chuckle in unbelief, while there are other times that our rebellion against you breaks your heart. We never mean to dethrone you, but that's exactly what we attempt to do when we take the reins from your hands and say, "I've got this, God. You sit this one out." How foolish can we be? Only fools say in their hearts that there is no God. And even when we act the utter fool, you forgive us. Over and over again, you stand us up when we fall, dust us off, and set us on the right path, usually knowing that we will make the same mistakes all over again. Your creation is truly amazing, but your love for us is far more remarkable. Your blessings and gifts are truly good, but your willingness to give those gifts to us that we certainly don't deserve is the greatest of all. Your desire to forgive is unthinkable, but your motivation to die a brutal death in order to accomplish that forgiveness leaves us speechless. 2 Samuel 7:21-22 says, "You are doing all these things just because you promised to and because you want to. How great you are, Lord God. We have never heard of any other God like you, and there is no other God. Thank you for being who you are. Thank you for being our Father. Please continue to watch over all those who are away from us, including all those missionaries we support as a family, those who are actively protecting our country in the various armed forces, and those who are worshiping with us from all over the world online. Remain steadfast in providing the wisdom to those who are currently seeking a treatment and ultimately a vaccine for the coronavirus. Encourage our loved ones who are in nursing facilities, and may we find creative ways to reassure them that they continue to be in our thoughts and prayers. Keep your hand of protection upon our loved ones that we are not able to be with temporarily. Help us to fight against loneliness and fear as we spread your love to those in our sphere of influence. May you be pleased with answering these our requests as we bring honor and glory to your name. We ask all of this in the name of your blessed Son, Jesus Christ, as we repeat the prayer he taught to his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen."
As we prepare for communion, I'd like to read the scripture, Romans chapter 5, starting verse 1 through verse 11. "Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand, and we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that sufferings produce endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given on to us. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. Indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person someone might actually dare to die. But God proves his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Much more surely then, now that we have been justified by his blood, we will be saved through him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his Son, much more surely, having been reconciled, we will be saved by his life. But more than that, we even boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, from whom we have now received reconciliation. So we come to the table to remember our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. He laid down his life to free the whole world of our sins. As we look to the cross, we're reminded of the suffering and shame that he endured for us. Let us remember that this freedom wasn't free. Jesus paid it all. Thank you, Jesus, for our freedom of sin. Let us pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we come this morning humbled to be called your children. That you thought enough of us and you loved us so much that you sent your one and only Son as a way that we could spend eternity with you. As we come to the table, we remember the cross. We remember the sacrifice that it took for that freedom. We remember the humiliation that our Lord and Savior endured. We remember the beatings. We remember how he hung on that cross. And in doing so, he was still forgiving the people that put him there. And we praise you and thank you for that unconditional love. And we praise you and thank you, Jesus, for that selfless service that you would endure death for us. So as we come to the table, I ask your blessing on each one here. Father, I ask that you would fill us with your Spirit and that we could grow deeper and deeper in love with you each and every day. We praise you and love you in Jesus' precious name. Amen. We partake of the loaf representing Jesus' broken body for us. And the cup that washes our sins white as snow.
Jesus Christ. Isaac Newton was one of the most influential scientists of his time and a devout follower of Jesus Christ. He wrote these words, "If I have seen a little further than others, it is because I have stood on the shoulders of giants." That is the essence of Memorial Day. It's about remembering those who have gone before us to bring us to this point in our lives. Life is not a vacuum. We have arrived at this place because we have stood on the relational, spiritual, intellectual, and financial shoulders of others. Others have played an important role in our lives to bring us to this point, to the blessings that we are enjoying this morning. I think of all the great men and women who gave their lives in serving in the military of this great nation so we could enjoy the personal and religious freedoms that we enjoy today. I think of the people in our own personal families who made sacrifices, who made sure that we had a roof over our head and food on our table. I think of our brothers and sisters in Christ who partnered with us in ministry in order to make sure that the gospel of Jesus Christ was proclaimed, who shared Christ with us, who baptized us, who taught us in Sunday school and in Bible study. Those who made sacrifices for us so that once they were gone from this planet, they made sure that their faith in Jesus Christ lived on in us. This point was driven home to me this last week as I reflected on the life of March Hagen. I had the privilege of preparing and leading a funeral service to honor her memory along with her family. She was one of the few people I have known since the very beginning of my ministry here at Blanchard. This November, I will have been in Blanchard for 27 years. I know, it's hard to believe. I came here preaching when I was 12 years old. I have known Marge for a really long time. And when you know someone for 27 years, you get to know them on their good days and their bad days. Marge was well-informed, and she had a well-rounded perspective regarding Russell Moldovan. And when you have the privilege of conducting ministry at the same place for multiple decades, you will have some bumps in the road. And the prayer and hope is always, always that you make good choices along the way. But when you stay that long, guaranteed, you're going to make some bad ones too. And I confess, I have done that. Multiple decades will provide you a chance to make some great friendships, to make some great relationships. At the same time, you're going to make some antagonistic ones and some enemies as well. Why? Two reasons. Number one, human sin. The Bible is brutally honest. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Human sin will get in the way of healthy friendships. But secondly, we have Satan. We read in 1 Peter, keep alert. Your adversary, the devil, he prowls around looking for someone to devour, looking for friendships to devour, looking for marriages to devour, looking for church leaders to devour, looking for pastors to devour, looking for congregations that he can devour. That's what Satan does. Jesus said, the thief, he comes to steal and to kill and to destroy. Listen, if you're going to do battle against the enemy, you have to know who your enemy is. He plays for keeps, he's a liar, and he is very sly. So, we have this toxic recipe, human sin and Satan, and the deck has been stacked against us. But praise God, we have Jesus Christ. With him, all things are possible. We can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. In Christ, we can whip Satan and we can whip sin. So, I have known Marge since the very beginning of my ministry. From the very beginning, she made it very clear that she was my ministry ally. She was in my spiritual corner. I could count on her as a pastor and as a friend. You know, all of us need someone like that in our lives who will love us on our best days and our worst days. And that was Marge. She supported me on my best days and also on my worst days. Can I share with you a secret? I know there's no Memorial Day parade tomorrow, but I'm going to share with you a secret that guarantees that you will have a prosperous and a fruitful Memorial Day weekend. Would you like me to do that? Doesn't matter whether there's a parade or no parade. Guaranteed. This secret is a four-step exercise that will guarantee that your Memorial Day weekend is one that's of blessing and of joy. One that is fruitful. So here we go. Number one. Remember on and reflect. Reflect on and remember those people who loved you unconditionally. Those who loved you on your best days and on your worst days. Oh, but Pastor, I don't have anyone like that in my life. I never did. Not true. Everyone has. God gives everyone someone in their life who is in their corner. At some point, you just have to reflect and remember, you might have to go in there and dig around a little bit. Maybe it was a parent. Maybe it was a grandparent. Maybe it was a neighbor down the street. Maybe it was a former boss. Maybe it was years and years ago. Maybe it was a church member who has since gone home to be with the Lord. But God has put someone in your corner at some point in your life who was cheering for you, who was loving you, and who was looking to assist you as you lived your life. And they did that unconditionally. Well, that person right now, this morning, may even be in heaven, cheering for you as you are taking your turn in the race of life. So that's number one. Reflect on and remember those who loved you unconditionally. Here is step two. Thank God for them. Thank God that He put those people in your corner. You know, that is why we have our special Memorial Day service every May, where we take time to read off the names of those who have left us to go home to be with the Lord, to reflect on and remember them, but also to thank God for their lives as they gave themselves to us and pointed our lives to Jesus Christ. Here's the third step. Commit yourself to follow in their footsteps. As these special people were to you, pay it forward and become that for someone else. Get in their corner, cheer for them, love on them unconditionally, on their best days, on their worst days, but be there for them. After Marge's graveside service last week, we were over in the Blanchard Cemetery. We held everything right there. We migrated over here underneath the pavilion, and we had pizza, and we had cake, they had a little burner, and we had tea. And we sat around and we told stories regarding Marge. And the family made it very clear that Marge adopted me as one of her sons. Nearly every week after worship, Marge would go pick up one of the sermon CDs from the previous week. And she would take it over and she'd give it to her oldest son, Neil. And she would say, "Neil, you have to listen to this sermon. He gives the very best sermons." And Neil was like, "Really, Mom, again? Listen, I know, I had Marge snowball. Yeah, she thought I walked on water. I don't know what I did to get in her corner, but praise God, I know that she took me before the throne of God many, many days in prayer, lifting me up, and I'm grateful. I am so grateful. We all need someone like that in our corner." And that's what she did. And how did she do that? How did she love me unconditionally? I didn't do anything to deserve it. She did it with this fourth step. She surrendered herself to God first. That's right. She surrendered herself to God first. The grace she displayed toward me, the great affection she had for me, I didn't earn it. It was all from God. Open your Bibles. 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 through 12. We read, "Beloved, let us love one another, because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love." God's love was revealed to us in this way. God sent His only Son into the world so that we might live through Him. And this is love, not that we love God, but that He loved us and sent His Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Beloved, since God loved us so much, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us and His love is perfected in us. God is love. And when you walk with God, His love lives inside of you, and it grows, and it starts to come out. And as it comes out, it goes all over the people around you, and you can't help it because it's all coming from Him. The byproduct of love is that it does just that. It reaches out, and it grabs other people, and you'll find yourself loving them unconditionally, and it gets all over them. You just can't help it. See, loving people unconditionally, that is a byproduct of our devotion to God. But the flip is also the same, the flip side. Our inability to love others is also a sign of our devotion to God, a sign of our lack of devotion to Him. Because when you're devoted to Him and you're loving Him, His love is on the inside of you, it just comes out. So that you're even loving your enemies, even praying for them. So that's my four-step exercise to a successful and fruitful Memorial Day weekend. Number one, reflect on and remember those who loved you unconditionally. Number two, thank God for them. Number three, pay it forward. Become that for someone else. Get in someone else's corner as those folks were in your corner. And number four, give yourself to God first through Jesus Christ. The psalmist wrote, "Blessed in the eyes of the Lord are the death of His saints." When I think of Marge Hagen, I think of precious to God. She is precious in death because to us, in this life, she was precious to us. While on earth, her precious life pointed us to our precious Savior, Jesus Christ. His love filled her heart and it overflowed. And she took that outpouring of love and she directed it and pointed it at us. She was an example of Jesus Christ to each of us. And now in her death, she is precious because she has received the promise that death in Christ is not death at all. It is simply a doorway to eternal life through Him. Amen. The last time I saw Marge Hagen, she was confined to a bed in a nursing facility. And throughout the day, the nursing staff would come because gravity would do its thing. Oh, as the day progressed, she would end up sliding down in her bed, and the nursing staff would come and they would hoist her up and prop her back up, only a few hours later to come and do that again. It was a constant routine. Three times a day, she was spoon-fed her meals. When it came to personal hygiene, she was confined to bath baths or baths in her bed. And when it came to visitation, her friends were not allowed into the nursing home to have face-to-face contact with her. Today, I'm here to tell you that Marge Hagen has been liberated from all of that. Today, she has received the promise and she walks in glory with Jesus Christ. Amen? Precious in the eyes of the Lord are the death of His saints. They are precious in death because in life they were precious in that they pointed us to Jesus Christ, who is our Lord and our Savior. And so I want to leave you with this scripture from 2 Corinthians. There the Apostle Paul, he wrote these words. So, we do not faint. We do not lose heart. For while our outward nature is wasting away, our inward nature is being renewed day by day. For these momentary afflictions are preparing us for an eternal weight of glory that's beyond all measure. For we look not at what is seen, but what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary. What is unseen, that's eternal. For if the earthly tent we live in be destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with human hands, waiting for us in the heavens. For in this tent we groan, longing to be clothed in our heavenly dwelling. For in this tent we groan, longing to be clothed in our heavenly dwelling. My friend, that's going to happen. One day He's going to come back. And we're going to be clothed with our heavenly dwelling. God has made all of that possible through Jesus Christ. And so again, I pray for a fruitful Memorial Day weekend for you. Four-step exercise guaranteeing that this weekend will be fruitful. Parade, no parade. Still fruitful. Number one, reflect and remember those who loved you unconditionally. Two, thank God for them. Three, pay it forward. Get in someone else's corner as someone was in yours. And four, surrender yourself first to God through his son, Jesus Christ. That's where it's all at. That's where our hope is. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but will have everlasting life. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but that through him the world might be saved. Surrender to him. You will not be sorry. The greatest gift you could receive this weekend is to receive the gift of Jesus, the gift of salvation, the gift of hope and life after death, the hope of seeing loved ones again. God did all of that through Jesus Christ. I hope that you are blessed by that message. Peace to you. God bless you. And before you go, I'd like to send you off with prayer. Almighty God, we thank you for this day. Thank you, dear Lord, for all of those shoulders that we have stood on that have brought us to this point. Family members, church members, teachers, pastors, Sunday school teachers, on and on we go, dear Lord. Thank you for them. For our military personnel, we enjoy so much freedom. Even today, even with this pandemic, here we are meeting, dear Lord, in Jesus' name. We thank you for all these souls, all these lives who have made this possible. And most importantly, we thank you for Jesus on this Memorial Day. He gave the greatest sacrifice of all, himself, innocent as he was, dying on our behalf. He said, no greater love than this, than to lay down one's life for one's friends. And he went and he did just that. We thank you, Lord Jesus. We praise you, and I pray that this faith will encourage your people this morning and this weekend and this next week. Watch over them. You have given us everything, not just now, but all of eternity. We praise you. We love you. We lift you up in your name. And all the Lord's people said, God bless you. Go in peace.